Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How's everybody today?
Blessed and highly favored.
This is a day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice because we have a choice. Amen.
Amen.
We have a choice. Now, Jesus says, learn from me. Learn. If you're not willing to learn, you could easily be burned. Hello? He said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Lack of knowledge. In other words, lack of truth, of understanding. He requires that we have understanding. He requires that we have wisdom and knowledge. He requires these things. Why? So we can overcome. Amen? We are in a time and season that is tremendous. Tremendous battle, tremendous fight. And if you're not in a battle, you become a casualty. Amen? If people would begin to fight spiritually, if they would deny themselves and put the king first and the kingdom first, we would be a lot further along than we are today.
Amen.
That's why he says, come out from among them. Amen?
Amen?
Be separate. Don't be entangled in the affairs of this world. Oh, to God be the glory. But we're at a power. You know, think about this. You and I are alive in this generation. God sent you into this realm at this time to fulfill a mission. Stop fulfilling your own and start fulfilling his. And you'll have more peace. You'll have more joy. Amen? See, when you try to fulfill your own, you're miserable. I just can't do it. You're right. You can't. No matter how much money you make, no matter what you do, you'll be miserable until you start fulfilling the mission that God sent you into this realm for. I don't care how many times you go to church. You know, you can pray and not fulfill. That's why it says, watch and pray. Why? Because you're supposed to be praying. God is supposed to be giving you something. Amen? And then he's giving you something and releasing things all day long. The problem is we get so caught up in ourselves, we miss it. And we don't want to miss anymore. Because we're in a time and season that is phenomenally awesome. We're escalating quickly. Very quickly. Righteousness is coming up faster. Evil's coming up faster. There's a lot of interruption of Satan's kingdom into the kingdom of God, but God is more interrupting his plans than Satan is interrupting God's plans. But I tell you, if people would pray the price in cooperation with what God's asking them to do, we'd be a farther along than what we are. The only reason why Jesus ain't here yet is because he'd lose too many. There's too many still caught up in the world. There's too many still serving two masters. He says you cannot serve two masters. Why? Because you'll go to hell. Does everybody get it? You cannot serve two masters. He didn't say you could. He said you can't. And there's too many still serving two masters. Would you go to 1 Timothy chapter 3? Oh, glory. First Timothy chapter 3. In verse 14. 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 14. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together. These things I write to you, though I hope to come to you shortly, but if I am delayed, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of the truth. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was what? God was manifested in the flesh. Now that's pretty wild, isn't it? Who was manifested in the flesh? God was manifested. He came, justified in the Spirit, seen by angels, preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up to glory. God was manifested. Everyone say, God was manifested. The Creator that created all things created Himself to come into the physical realm. Titus 1. Glory. Man, there's just a flow right now. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit just... Woohoo! Titus chapter 1 and verse 1. Is everybody there? We didn't have far to go. Praise God. Let's speak it together. Paul, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect and the acknowledgement of the truth, which accords with godliness, in hope of what? Eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began, promised before creation. Before he even created time. Has everybody got it? Verse 3. But has in due time what? Manifested his word. Why? The word says the word became flesh and dwelt among us. God used the word of God to make a body. So God's body was not made of the dust. It was made of the word. But has in due time manifested his word through preaching, which was committed to me according to the commandment of God, our Savior. It was promised before time was manifested or created, and he manifested his word, which he used to make a body. So everybody got it. God did this. It says that God, his son, called himself, his word was in his bosom. He pulled him out. Said, here I come. He said, you going to be me. And I'm going to send you, because I'm going to send me into the world. I'm going to call you son, because you, me and you, like father, like son. So that the world may know you as son, but I want them to know you as me. So when they see you, they see me. 1 John chapter 3. Hallelujah. 1 John chapter 3, verse 7. God manifested. Everyone say, God manifested. Boy, did he manifest. Amen. Amen? So that's it, I'm coming. The devil's deceiving too many of my kids. That's it, I'm done, I'm coming. I don't care what kind of price I got to pay. I got to come and rescue my kids. And I want to release them from the pits. I want to release them from Hades so they can come home to me. So I need to put on sin so I can go down there and get them. Because the only requirement to get into hell is to become sinful. Oh, glory. If everybody could grab hold of that. Verse 7. What does it say? Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God, who is what?
Manifested.
Wait a minute. Who is what?
Manifested.
Who's the Son of God? Is he God? Hello. Okay, let's say this again. For this purpose, the Son of God, who is? Who is God that was manifested? Now we're going to say this again. For this purpose, the Son of God, who is who?
God.
Thank you very much. Shish kebaba. Who was?
God.
Was
God.
Manifested. Dear God, we got to have three sessions on this? Anyways. Hallelujah. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that we might that he might destroy the what? Works of the devil. So God manifested. He created his own body, the Word, by his Spirit, because God is Spirit, came into this realm. Amen? God, man. Man, God. Now, he came in to do what? Destroy the works of the devil. That he might destroy the works of the devil. See, he was going to do his part. Now, we got to do the rest. He did his part. Now, we continue on doing his part. But this is where God says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because they're really living their lives. They're not destroying Satan's kingdom. Because they don't know how to warfare. They don't know how to fight. They don't know how to access. They don't even know how to cast out a devil. Every believer ought to cast out a devil. Every believer ought to be able to lay hands on the sick. Every believer ought to worship. Every believer ought to pray in tongues. It's just religious garbage that prevents devil's interruption, religiosity, cultural belief systems that deny Christ in the fullness of him. Amen. That he might destroy the works of the devil. You can't destroy it in your own strength. That's why you need to have the anointing. Amen. Oh, glory. Is everybody okay? Now, you ready? Verse 9. For whoever has been born of God doesn't sin. That's a state of being. It's a born-again state of being. It's associated with the tabernacle place, the chambers. For his seed does what? Remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God. In other words, he doesn't allow sin to reign. In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are what? Manifested. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is he who does not love his brother. And this is the message that you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Does everybody got this? So the Son of God, God, was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. Does everybody got it? He came to destroy. What was the devil doing? He was killing, stealing, killing, and what? Destroying God's people. So Jesus, the name that's above all names, God gave him. Many people don't realize that the word Jehovah means God, but it's not his name. Because it was associated with Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Shema, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah God the healer, Jehovah God the Savior, Jehovah God. Does everybody understand that? But Jesus, when God created himself to come into physical realm, he said, I'm going to put every one of those names in one. Put it right on the name of Jesus. So that the name of Jesus, every name of God representing a manifestation of God, is fulfilled in one name now. Doesn't the enemy love to come in and get all kinds of stupid stuff? Amen. So you got all these people, you got Jehovah Witnesses, no, just only Jesus. You got all of these goofy religious things that go on that prevent the power of God. Because you know why? They don't believe Jesus is God. Oh, glory. So what did Jesus do? He came. Not only did he die for me and you, he rose again. He left us keys of the kingdom as weapons. He left his name, his word, his blood, and his spirit. Amen. So we have no excuse. The whole thing is accepting it, believing it, and executing it. Isaiah 14. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. How you have fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will what? Ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farther sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High God. That's when the Lord said, that's enough. You did enough eyes in my throne. You can take your eye out of here. The problem is they put it on every dollar bill. Oh, hallelujah. And Jesus said, you shall be brought down to hell, the lowest depths of the pit. So we see here that Lucifer's fall, who was beautiful, full of wisdom, was removed from the first reality of God, his throne, his presence. Again, he was beautiful. He was the first angel created. He was God's right-hand man in the arena of the praise and worship leader of the universe. The earth was known as the mountain of God. This place was inhabited by angels. And Lucifer was in charge. But he exalted himself. He wanted people to worship him instead of God. And the Lord removed him. And when he removed him, Lucifer became ugly. He lost his beauty. He turned his wisdom to cunningness and craftiness. But he still carried a light, but it's a false light because he was known as the light bearer. So now he covers his ugliness because he's a serpent. Also a shapeshifter, but I ain't getting into all that today. He covers himself with light. He makes people think he's beautiful. He's the promoter of all religion. False religion. Has everybody got this? And God removed him. But when God removed him, and then Lucifer deceived Eve, Lucifer restored himself in order and ruler of this earth. And Jesus had to come and take his authority away. And he gives his authority only to those who follow him. I'm going to say those who follow him. Why? Because if you can't submit to authority, you have none. So you can be a believer all you want, but if you ain't submitting to authority, the devil knows you got none. Genesis chapter 3. God manifested. People argue over this, the Trinity of God and all kinds of things. Why? Because that's the infiltration of the enemy, isn't it? Well, Jesus is only the Son of God. No reality. You know why? Because what the devil promotes is false revelation. I'm going to say that again. The devil promotes false revelation. He sends his angels to appear to people with plates so they start a new religion. It's like counterfeit. They were printing money, except for they were printing Bibles or some kind of a new Bible or whatever. So the angels appear to these people. Does everybody get it? Because they are fallen angels. They're deceptive. And they start all of these religions. But God manifested to stop all the foolishness and left the spirit of truth so that you and I could be led by truth, know truth, live truth, and live in the spirit, which is called the realm of truth. And Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1. Verse 1. The serpent was what? More cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. Why? Because a beast is known as a fallen angel. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat, nor shall you what? Touch it, lest you what? Lest you die. In other words, you get removed from this realm. Remember, they were able to see the serpent, amen? they saw God. So the devil wanted to become invisible to them. Does everybody get it? The greatest strategy is in a war is to not be known or seen. So the serpent deceived them. They partook. I'm not going to get into all that. And in verse 9, then the Lord God called to Adam and said, "Where are you?" And Adam said to him, "I heard your voice in the garden," because I couldn't see you no more. Because I partook what I wasn't supposed to. I disobeyed. "And I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. And the Lord said to him, who told you that you were naked?" Who told you that? What was he trying to bring to Adam? Where did this come from? So you can go to whotoldyouthat.co and get a shirt that says, "Who told you that?" And we will produce more messages. But he said, "Who told you that?" In other words, he was trying to bring reality to him of what's seen and what's unseen now. You know how many times people don't realize what they're listening to? Who told you that? Somebody say something stupid to them, wouldn't you like to say, "Who told you that? Where did that come out of your mouth? Who told you you could lie and steal and cheat? Who told you to go use drugs and smoke cigarettes? Who told you to steal from God of his tithes and offerings? Who told you that?" Fear. Fear is what interrupts people from fulfilling God's will. And it's the power of Satan which uses fear. But Satan's greatest weapon is deception. Amen? Let's go. Are you ready? Verse 11. So he said, "Man, I was afraid and I hid myself." And the Lord said, "Who told you that, homie?" Said, "Have you eaten? Have you partaken of what I told you not to do?" Then the man said to the woman, of course, "Wait a minute. Whom you gave me," he was doing his passing blame. "Whom you gave me, it's her fault." And then the Lord said to the woman, "What have you done?" And she said, "It's the serpent's fault." I said, "Well, okay, we got a problem here." So the Lord said to the serpent, "Because you've done this, you are cursed more than all cattle, more than every beast of the field. And on your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put hatred, enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his" what? "Heel." So the serpent from beautiful angel covered himself with light, made himself beautiful, enticed the woman, seduced her and so forth, and produced all kinds of stuff. Listen, he is the deceiver of the world. Again, he's the one that promotes religiosity. He promotes what? Pagan rituals and worships of himself, because he was with God in creation, so he knows. How many of y'all know that he knows even events and the feasts and all kinds of things that are coming? Do you know that he, from this point, when God said, "Look, there's going to be hatred between both of your seeds, and one's going to hurt you big time. You'll bruise, but one's going to actually destroy you." So from that point on, Lucifer, Satan, was trying to interrupt and interfere and stop what God was trying to do. Does everybody understand that? He's still trying to interrupt to stop what God is trying to do. So what does he do? He establishes all kinds of pagan rituals and all kinds of things that counterfeit and interrupt all truth of God with his lies, his rituals, false promises to mankind. So they never find truth or identity or eternity. So they never find what? Truth, identity, or eternity. Wow. See, he knew God was coming for him. He knew he was going to come through man and then himself. So, but he got it. That's why Jesus is the way, truth, and life, right? Isaiah 9, God manifested. Isaiah 9 and verse 6. Prophesied by Isaiah. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And the government will be what? Upon his shoulder, and his name will be called what? Wonderful Counselor. Wait a minute. Mighty God. Everlasting what? Father. And what? Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be what? No one. It's an eternal kingdom. Everything else is temporary. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with what? Judgment and what? Justice. So God is the God of love, but his love will destroy unrighteousness. For the time, from that time forward, and even forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Wow. So as prophesied by Isaiah, God will send his word of self, in other words, manifest his word in a body, into the world to rescue, restore, and empower those willing to follow him. I'm going to say it again. He will put on flesh his word. He will come in the spirit. And he will come to rescue, restore, and empower. Rescue, restore, and empower those willing to follow him. Those not willing to follow him won't be empowered. Philippians 2. Come to what? Rescue, restore, and empower. You know, many people accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and go their own way. Then they look for a place that will teach them the same thing. It's okay, Jesus is everything to you now, right? He's Lord. No, he's only Savior. Lord is in the second chamber of the tabernacle. When he becomes Lord, you don't have a life. Amen? Amen. You don't live for you no more. Your counsel, correction, and direction comes from the throne room of God and through his servants in office. We look for conviction. Amen? We want to be convicted of anything that we're doing wrong by the Holy Spirit. Why? Because you want to maintain a right standing with God. Philippians chapter 2. Everybody there? I'm getting there. Hallelujah. In verse 5. Philippians 2 and verse 5. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God. Now that's powerful. Why? Because he was God. But made himself of no reputation. Hello? No reputation. So many people fight for their reputation. Who gives a hoot? We just want people to see Christ in us. Amen? But made himself with no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of a man. And being found in appearance as a man, he what? Humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, or given him every name associated with the manifestation of God. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Of those in heaven, well, we got access to the unseen. Those on the earth, to the seen. And those under the earth, we have access everywhere in the name of Jesus. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus is Lord. Wow. If he's Lord, is he God? Yes. To the glory of the Father. Wow. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with what? fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Powerful. John 14. God manifested. Why are we getting this? Because God wants you to have this tool, this weapon, because there's so much foolishness. John 14 and verse 5. John 14, 5, what's it say? Timothy said to Jesus, Lord, we do not know where you're going, and how can we know the way? And Jesus said, I am the what? The way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except for through me. In other words, no one can get to the Father except for through the Father. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him, and you what? You have seen him. Hello? Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it's sufficient for us. Jesus said, who told you that? And Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Is that powerful or what? God manifested. Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrew. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 1. God who at what? Various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets. And has in these last days spoken to us by his. So God sent his voice into this world. So that you and I could be on the same level of language. Until we are got baptized and restored our language from heaven. Does everybody get this? By his son, he sent his voice. Whom he has appointed heir of all things. To whom also he made the worlds. Who made the worlds? God. And what's his name? Jesus. Who being the brightness of his glory and express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins and sat at the right hand of the majesty on high. Having become so much better than the angels, as he had by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. For to which of the angels did he ever say, you are my son, and today I have begotten you? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be a son. But when he again brings the firstborn into the world, he says, let all the angels of God worship him. And of the angels, he says, who makes his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. But to the Son he says, are you ready for this? Your throne, O God. He says this to the Son. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is a scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, Jesus, your God, has anointed you with a what? Oil of gladness more than your companions. And you, Lord, in the beginning laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all grow old like a garment, like a cloak. You will fold them up, and they will be changed. But you are the same, but your years will not fail. But to which of the angels, as he said, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. And they, not are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for those who will inherit salvation, which is me and you? Revelation 12. Revelation chapter 12. God manifested. I mean, you all know God speaks in the heavens. He already played it all out in the 12 constellations. It's the story of Jesus' birth, death, and resurrection in every constellation. And everything is associated with lining up with the stars. Now, Daniel, you got to remember that God taught them these things by his Spirit. In fact, even Adam and Eve knew certain things in the stars. And things were brought down. The problem is the enemy always interrupts and corrupts and counterfeits, doesn't he? That's where people still read their horoscopes. Your horoscope don't mean poop. Hello? Just an open door to more demonic activity, so stop reading it because you're cursing yourself. You want to read something about your future? Here it is. Amen. You don't need to go to tarot cards or anything else. It's all demonic, and you curse yourself, and it goes down your family line to your children. Amen? So in this, God set the whole story, all truth of Jesus' birth, death, resurrection, and return as king. All in the constellations. Now, Daniel was one with wisdom. God gave him great wisdom and knowledge and understanding. So Daniel knew about the things of in heaven and the stars and how to read them according to God's plan and not man's plan. So when Daniel was taken captive by the Babylonians and put in captivity, there were those called the Chaldeans. And they were star readers. The problem is they were demonic. Daniel trained them to read the stars correctly. So after many generations and many years, the wise men were Chaldeans. See, they could read the stars and knew when a king was going to be born in Bethlehem, meaning house of bread. They knew when that star would come. And they were going to wait because they could see the shift in Jupiter and Venus. And they could read the stars in the area of a birth that was coming. In fact, in the book of Revelation, in chapter 12 and verse 1, here's a picture of a constellation. Let's read it. Now a great sign appeared in heaven, and a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Then being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to what? To give birth. Wow, this is powerful. Now we know that the woman is a representation of Mary who would be pregnant. Amen? But it's also a representation of Israel. Israel, which is the place. Amen? And the 12 tribes of Israel. Also, we have when Mary came forth, which related to the 12 apostles. Okay. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold the what? A great fiery red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems on his head. And his tail drew a third of the stars of heaven, threw them to the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to destroy her child as soon as it was born. Now, I want you to understand that this dragon is also known as Herod, because he stood before to try to destroy. Does everybody understand that? Okay. Verse 5. She bore a male child, which was to rule all the nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up to God and his throne. Then the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Now, this is powerful. Now, let's go to, again, the dragon was Herod. I'm going to go to Matthew 2 for a minute so we can get a better understanding of this. Is everybody there? Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born?" He's been already born. Does everybody get this? King of the Jews. For we have seen his star in the east and have come to what? Worship him. When Herod the king heard of this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. But he was already born. So they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it was written by the prophet, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who shall shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them that what star that appeared, and he said to them, Bethlehem, and said, go and search carefully for the young child. See, this was occurring. Jesus was already 2 years old. So I just want you to get the truth about what's up. So these wise men, the Chaldeans, were not there at Jesus' birth. They brought gifts to him after he was 2 years old. And he sent to Bethlehem, go search carefully for the young child, and when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also. When they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. They were shouting, Yoo-hoo! And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child, not a baby, with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the child to destroy him. When he rose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, out of Egypt I called my son. And Herod sent word out to kill any child from 2 years of age, younger, all male children. Does everybody got it? Okay, now go to Luke chapter 2. Oh, hallelujah. God manifested. So the wise men rejoiced exceedingly. And in Luke 2 and verse 8, it says, now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Christ. Now, this was the day of the birth of Christ. The angels went to the shepherds, amen, and spoke to them. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in the manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men. So I want you to understand that when Jesus came into the world, there was a shout and praise. When the wise men showed up, there was a shout and praise. And when he comes again, there were going to be a shout and praise. Now, I want to get to a point because it's important that we understand that everything revolves around the tabernacle of God and the feast of the Lord. The tabernacle of God and the feast of the Lord in Leviticus 23. I want to go here quick. Leviticus 23. God manifests. Gosh, if the whole world would just understand that God came. People don't have to argue about Jesus, the Son of God. He was God. God came. Only God could take on the sins of mankind. Only God could rise again from the dead. And only God can offer salvation and eternal life. Leviticus 23. Leviticus 23, 1 and 2. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, the feast of the Lord, not feast of man, the feast of the Lord, which you shall proclaim to be holy convocation, these are my feasts. Wow. Those are whose feasts? His feasts. Now, we know that Jesus is the only one that can fulfill them, even though that they practiced them in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament. But when Jesus came, when God came, he was the one that was going to fulfill everything that was spoken about the feast. Why? Because feasts are associated with times of visitations and events. Does everybody get this? That's why, you know what? Many believers don't even know about this. They don't even know about feasts of the Lord. They have no idea. They're out there just going, whatever. Oh, yeah, I love Jesus and whatever. And they really have no idea. They have no fight. They're no nothing. They're standing out in an outer court, no effect to the kingdom of darkness. Never expanding God's kingdom. They're maintaining their own selfish kingdom and not expanding the kingdom of God. And in these feasts, the first feast is called the Feast of Passover, where Jesus is known as the way. That's called the cross. The second feast is a feast of unleavened bread. And leaven means evil, where Jesus died on the cross. He descended into hell, took the keys of death, hell, and the grave from the serpent, Lucifer. And there's the Feast of First Fruits, where Jesus rose from the dead. And then 50 days later, he sent his spirit. And that's called the Day of Pentecost, which you can read in Acts chapter 2. So Jesus fulfilled the first four feasts. Has everybody got it? The fifth feast is called the Feast of Trumpets, which has still got to be fulfilled. In fact, that Feast of Trumpets is called the Jewish New Year. It's called Rosh Hashanah. It's called the New Year. It is the feast through the Jews. But you and I, it's also known called the Feast of Trumpets. But it is the New Year. In fact, in September 21st and 22nd of 2017, which is coming up, will be the next feast to be fulfilled. Amen? That we celebrate or acknowledge. Who knows? It may be fulfilled. Why? Because on the 23rd of 2017, the image of Revelation 12 will be able to be seen. Does everybody get that? It will all line up with all the stars and the moons, Jupiter and Venus. It will be seen. That's pretty amazing. Is it possible it could be the rapture of the church? Very possible. Very possible. But we don't know the days and times, do we? But we sure got an idea that things are getting ready to happen quickly. According to the computer analysis and movements of stars and planets and everything, it will appear the 23rd. 2017. Now I want you to grab hold of this, because the Lord said this generation will not pass by where I will not, where I will return. And the generation started when Israel became a nation in 1948. And a generation is 70 years long. So that means 2018. Again, very possible. Is everybody okay? Now remember, it's called the Feast of Trumpets, right? Well, there's no coincidence that we have a president elected called Trump. To all those who don't understand who they voted for. Anyways, Trump. Last Trump. 1 Thessalonians 4. So we see that the angels shouted, didn't they? The shepherds shouted, when the angels appeared to them. The wise men shouted. Now, First Thessalonians 4. Verse 13. Is everybody there? But I do not want you to be what? Ignorant, brethren, concerning those that have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. In other words, those in Christ will be raised first, fulfilling the Feast of Trumpets. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a what? With a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Now, I want you to grab hold of this. Remember, the shepherds shouted on the day of birth. Amen. The wise men shouted 2 years later. Listen, if you take the Feast of Trumpets, and you go back 9 months, it becomes December. See, the Jews look at conception as birth. So it's very most likely Jesus was conceived on the Feast of Trumpets. So everybody got it. Verse 17. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds and meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Has everybody got this? Remember, it's why it's called the Feast of Trumpets. It's a new year. When Jesus came into this realm, when he was conceived, everything changed. Now, following the Feast of Trumpets is called the Feast of Atonement or Yom Kippur, which is actually 10 days of repentance. You don't think people are going to repent after they see the rapture? Man, they're going to repent like crazy. Especially many of those people called believers, called Christians that weren't right with God, that didn't follow and chose to do their own thing. They're going to repent big time, aren't they? Now, I'm sharing all this because God was manifest, but I want you to know that the devil portrays and counterfeits everything. Amen? Go to Genesis 10. There's so many things that are going on that are ridiculous. If everybody would just accept that God was manifested, it wouldn't be so much of a problem. But they got all these goofy religions. Genesis 10 and verse 8. Is everybody there? Cush begot Nimrod. He began to be a what? Mighty hunter on the earth. Nimrod was a Nephilim. He was mighty hunter before the Lord. Therefore it is said, like Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord. And the beginning of his kingdom was what? Babel. That's where Babylonian. He was known as the king. In fact, Nimrod was the king. It says Babylon, Iraq, Assad, Shalon, and then land of Shinar, which is Iraq and so forth. So he was king. He built this huge tower. They were all one language. He was king of the world. And they knew about the flood because this was after the flood, so they wanted to build a tower big enough to not only reach God or heaven, but to hopefully escape in case God chose to bring a flood again. Wrong. Now, Nimrod was actually born on December 25th. Another counterfeit. Nimrod married his mother. So we got mother-wife. And when he died, his mother-wife said that he came to her as God and impregnated her. Sound familiar? Counterfeit? And she produced a son. And she said that the son was a resurrection of Nimrod. That's where you have gods and goddesses and pagan ritual. Does everybody get it? So we see that Satan's kingdom is always interrupting and trying to bring something ritualistic, a ritual pagan event to counterfeit so that he could be worshipped on the day that God is worshipped. Is everybody okay? But see, if you have the Spirit, you know all things. And God judges by the heart, doesn't he? Problem is sometimes the heart is wicked. So we celebrate Christmas and feasts and so forth. And if you really get it, look how many places now. I mean, you know, we were at a restaurant and they came up and said, Happy Holiday. They couldn't say Merry Christmas. Because the ruler of this earth. You got all of these laws that are coming into effect and you got all of these organizations that are anti-Christ. So you can't say Merry Christmas. You can say Happy Holidays or something to that degree. You know, even the White House doesn't acknowledge Jesus. Does anybody get it? In fact, they said that we're no longer a Christian country. I can imagine what they do behind closed door, even though they put the tree up. I'm going to close at 1 John chapter 2. God manifested. Is everybody okay? First John chapter 2, verse 15, praise God. So we don't worship the event, amen, or any event. We don't worship the feasts. We worship the King. Where many people worship the event, which is called paganism. But we know God manifested. Verse 15, read it. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. He who does the will of God abides forever. Only he who does the will of God. So you need to start fulfilling your mission. Amen. Little children, it is the last hour. And as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us, for if they had been with us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. But you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. I have not written to you because you don't know the truth, but because you know it, and that the no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? Now, you got to understand something. That also represents Jesus as God. Because Christ is a representation of the eternal presence and power of God Almighty, who is God. He is Antichrist, who denies the Father and the Son. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. Why? Because Jesus is God. He who acknowledges the Son has the Father also. Therefore, let that abide in you, which you have heard from the beginning. If what you heard from the beginning abides in you, you also will abide in the Son, who is God, and the Father. And this is the promise that he has promised to us. What? Eternal. Why? If you're not abiding in God, how can you have eternal life? Wow. These things I have written to you concerning those who try to what? Deceive you with religious garbage and pagan rituals and selfish ambitions. But the anointing, the eternal presence and power of God Almighty, the Spirit of God, which you have received from him, abides in you, and you don't need anyone to teach you. Why? Because as the same anointing teaches you concerning these things and is true and is not a lie, and just as is taught you, you will abide in him. So remember, God is always trying to get you to abide in him. Why? To maintain the anointing, to maintain connection, to touch the glory, to live in the realm of truth, so that you are victorious, so that you carry the banner of Christ, that you manifest his name, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world, and you are more than conquerors. We are blessed with every spiritual blessing seated in heavenly places. We are the righteousness of God. And if God be for you, who can be against you? Amen. God manifested. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. Father, we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. We thank you for your mercies, your grace, and your faithfulness, for your divine revelation and exposing false revelation. We thank you. Let this seed be protected by the blood of the Lamb, and let it grow and bear fruit for your glory. Grant in us eyes, ears, and hearts to see this all the way through, as we maintain identity in you, in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.